Ash is one of the most biggest playmaking ADCs in Wild Rift right now, especially with this low cooldown build. This allows you to make plays across the map with the ultimate. Now, so for the items, you're going to want to go Man Immune, Trinity Force, Stasis, Aura Protobelt, Blade of the Rune King, Mortal Reminder for that heal cutting, and Guardian Angel. Now, for the runes, you're going to want to go Conqueror, Brutal, Hunter Titan, and Sweet Tooth. And you guys might be wondering, why not run Lethal Tempo? I came down to the conclusion that Conqueror is just honestly better than Lethal Tempo in many ways, really. So I think you should just go Conqueror and you're going to get a lot more value with it. Now, you can go Mana Flow Band, but you don't really have a mana problem with this build. So you really can go Sweet Tooth to have stronger traits in lane. And for the spells, you're gonna wanna go Exhaust and Flash. So in this gameplay, we actually played, it was a pretty high elo game and it was pretty intense and there was a lot of interesting things that happened. So I hope you guys do enjoy. And if you do, make sure to like the video and subscribe for more content. And with that, let's hop right on into the gameplay. All right, guys, we are now in the game. And yeah, guys, Ash is a big playmaker, one of the biggest Wild Rift ADC playmakers currently. And it's because of this build, she has such a low ultimate cooldown that she's always able to look for picks around the map. And guys, if you guys are wondering why I put that pink ward there, it's actually something I got from watching the Icon series. And what this allows is for when the enemy team wards your tribush, their ward gets disabled without seeing the pink ward. So that's what's really good about it. You don't even need to put the ward in the tribush so the enemy doesn't take it. Because if the enemy takes it, they get some XP for it, which could be bad for your lane because that means they could get level 2 before you, and you don't want that. You don't want to give the enemy an advantage when it is avoidable. So in this laning phase, guys, we got Gragas Ashe versus Lulu Kai'Sa. So as Gragas Ashe, we outrange them, and we also have Font that we can proc. So Gragas needs to land the barrel, and I need to land my W. Ashe is one of the best laners in Wild Rift. She's really strong because of her range, because of that W. The W does so much damage, and it literally hits from so far. I think it's pretty OP, and they actually nerfed it a little recently, like a couple of patches ago, because it was really strong. But yeah, so as you can see, we're staying more healthier than the Kai'Sa and Lulu because of the Font. Since our jungler is on our scuttle side, we're gonna shove in the wave to either for our jungler to get their blue buff or whatever the jungler wants to do. But if the jungler goes onto the blue side, then I'm gonna go help the jungler in the blue side. And if not, I'm gonna reset. And since the jungler decided to go to mid, I'm gonna just reset. I do think that the Nunu should have just invaded and taken the blue, but it's okay. I reset, I get the tier, and now I'm starting to get back to my way in lane. Now, in the top lane, guys, look at what happened. Boom! Veigar with the cage, stunning up the Nunu and the Lux, which forces our teammates to die, which is not the best for us because as Ashe, you want to win the early game, to be honest. You don't want to fall behind with Ashe because this Ashe build does not scale into the late game for you to do a bunch of damage. Like, that's not what this Ashe build is for. This Ashe build is designed for you to get picks with the ultimate to push your lead into a snowball. And basically, you kind of want to get your teammates fed with it. So that's why it's very, very important for your team not to fall behind. But it's okay. It's ranked. Things happen. You're not going to be in full control of things. So there's going to be mistakes that happen. My Gragas goes in onto the Kai'Sa and loses his entire HP. Honestly, I should have exhausted Kai'Sa earlier, but I think Gragas should have just not gone on Kai'Sa like that. And luckily, I didn't flash on top of Kai'Sa to kill her because they were baiting me with the heal. So luckily, I was smart enough not to do that, which is really good by me. Finally, I get my Ashe ult, and now I'm in a position to really start looking for picks. I body blocked that Kai'Sa W just to make sure that my Gragas doesn't get sniped from it. I see my Lux coming down here, so I'm kind of looking for the pick, but I know that Lux needs to go back to mid. So what I want to do is shove this wave so I can reset and be really healthier. But at the same time, I'm not in a rush because maybe there could be a pick available for me. The Master Yi was spotted by my vision that I placed. My Nunu tried to gank, but there was really nothing to gank here, so at this moment, I really, really want to recall because my Gragas is too low to really walk up into the lane, and the Veigar is also here. So I'm going to let this Kai'Sa shove in the wave so that I could clear it. because I really want to recall and pick up my Manamune, but I can't recall right now because there's another wave. So as you guys can see, I was gonna recall, but I'm like, okay, there's another wave right here. We should just clear it and then reset and get what's considered a cheater recall. So we end up shoving this wave in, because it's just more convenient for us. And yeah, so we shove in the wave, we start channeling our resets, and now I can get the Manamune. So right there, I looked at the mid lane to see if I could get a pick, because if I Ash ult someone, Lux can just root E ult and then E like pop the E, which would be high burst of damage. But honestly, it's kind of too hard to synchronize when you don't have the player in voice call. So sadly, we end up losing the play on the turret. Kai'Sa was able to get to lane quicker, but it is alright. Dragon is spawning up soon. So we're gonna need to make sure we get Pryo in our lane because of that, but our jungler ends up getting super chunked. So what we gotta do is we gotta make sure we shove in this wave at least. I think it's pretty greedy of this Kai'Sa to walk up like the way she did, but I know not to Ash ult her because there's no point. Like, there's no one near me that could do high burst damage. I need the Lux or the Lucian at least with us for us to do a high burst damage. So we are kind of just waiting for them to start it, right? Since our Nunu got chunked, we're in no position to really start the objective. So we end up kind of trying to go and contest this, and we want to mess around with them. So we end up popping out the Veigar cage, and then Nunu blasted coned over or flashed over, and I Ash ulted the Kai'Sa and the Lux ulted the Kai'Sa as well, and the fight was just a GG. I end up exhausting the Garen to make sure he can't come in and burst anyone, and we won that fight lights out. The reason why we won that fight so easily is because our comp is really well rounded, right? And the reason for that is we have Lucian Lux, which is our high burst damage carries, or our consistent damage in team fights, right? Which is really important to have. Then we have Nunu, which is a tank, and Gragas, which is a tank. And then there's me, which provides slows and more CC for the team fights. While on the other side, the enemy team has a bunch of hyper carries. They got Veigar, which is a late game carry. They have Kai'Sa, which is a mid to late game carry. And they have a Master Yi, which is another hyper carry in the mid and late game. They have too many carries. Lulu's only going to be able to buff one of them. And they're very squishy because they only have Garen to frontline. So if Garen's not there, they're all a target for me. And because of that, this is what makes the Ashe pick so strong. If you guys are curious when you guys should be picking Ashe, well, you want to pick Ashe into squishy comps. If the enemy team has a super tanky comp like Garen or Shen, Vi, and Alistar, you're not going to want to play Ashe because you don't really have any targets. You want to play Ashe when, like, they have an Enchanter, a squishy ADC, squishy mid laner. Like, if they have a Jinx, Ziggs, Nami, or Janet, you know, just squishy comps, or even assassins are kind of squishy. Like, if they have a... If they, like, depending on the assassins, like, you could just easily burst them with just hitting your Ashe ult. So, as long as they don't have a lot of tanks, so, then Ashe is good. And also, another thing is, so, the enemy team needs, you need to make sure the enemy team doesn't have any tanks. Oh, right here, guys, this was beautiful. I saw that Master Yi was sieging in turret, so I ult Master Yi, and Nunu follows up with a beautiful snowball, securing the kill. So, also, you need to look at and make sure that your team has a lot of damage. Has a lot of damage. Because Ashe is not going to do a lot of damage with this build. It's just going to be providing CC for your team and some damage. But mainly CC, right? You're going to slow them with your auto attacks. You're going to provide vision. And your ultimate is a stun for every 30 seconds, right? So you want to make sure your team has damage. If your team has damage, then you could go Ashe. But don't go Ashe if you have, like, a team that does no damage. Like, if you're playing with a TF, and then you have, like, a Malphite top, like, okay, you have a lot of CC already. Your teammates don't need this type of Ashe build. They need you to be doing damage. So, yeah, that's when this build and this pick won't really come in handy. So you want to make sure you pick it into squishy comps while your team also has enough damage to follow up. So right here, I see my Gragas getting caught out. So I really want to make sure I protect him by sending in an Ashel, I end up hitting Kai'Sa, which gives my Lux enough time to rotate in. The Gragas ends up baiting the Kai'Sa to come back in, and then the Lux roots and combos the Kai'Sa into death. And then the Lulu gets rooted by the Nunu, which makes them both fall. This allows us to push in a wave to secure the turret in the bot lane, which really opens up the map. And this is really huge for Ashe, because Ashe wants to open up the map. Ashe wants space to push forward and look for those ultimates. If the enemy team is able to just sit under their towers all the time, then you're not really going to be able to get picks. So that's really huge for us being able to open up the map. Now I'm running down the mid lane because I want to look for picks. I'm seeing my teammates fighting, so I'm Ashe ulting mid. But even though my teammates disengage, it's still good for me to send in my Ashe ult. Since even though you guys saw right there, the Lux was still able to follow up, even though I did ult a different target. Veigar ends up using the cage, and we want to kind of keep pushing since we did get the Garen caught out. But, you know, it's still kind of hard, but since we do have the wave and I'm able to poke with my W, the Veigar does need a back off, which gives us easy access on this turret. The turret ends up falling fast. I do have a ward up. I should be looking to place this ward, but I think I'm so... Guys, one thing I realize is I'm so bad with wards. Like, why didn't I place a single ward on the blue or in the river? Like, I could have placed it. So right here, I was deciding to ult, but I realized, like, there's no point. Like, the Master Yi is going to get the turret, and I would rather just keep it to maybe if my teammates spawn mid. I decided not to really engage with the Master Yi because there is a chance he could kill me, or at least I don't really feel like burning my flash or burning, you know, my exhaust right now. Even though it's okay to do that. But right here, I try to ult the Master Yi and I just miss anyway. So it's so bad. Like, I should have tried to ult Master Yi because ulting in that way is really hard to hit. I exhaust the Master Yi and force him to queue out of the fight. Veigar is caught. I don't know. He's walking to Narnia. I see the Kai'Sa already ulted, so I'm trying to go on the Kai'Sa. The Kai'Sa flashed over, so I flashed. I W flash to Chaser and Executor, and then I help chow down the Lulu. Now the Master Yi is the last target up. The Gragas ended up juking out the Master Yi, which was good because he was able to live and we were able to catch him out. And it was just another wipeout by us in the team fights. So now we're in a position to really just go catch waves, clear jungle. After winning a team fight, you want to make sure you continuously push your lead by making sure you stay on tempo. And tempo is basically how fast you get on and around the map. So after a team fight, it's like, okay, can you take an objective? Okay, if you can't, reset, or you want to make sure you're doing something positive. So after that team fight, oh, right here, I land. I tried to squeeze that Ashe ult onto the Garen, but at the end of the day, too many people were there. But you want to make sure you get on the map quick. So, you know, I decided to reset, shop, clear out the top wave, get scuttle. You know, I'm making sure I'm doing something all the time and not wasting any time around the map. Tempo is one of the biggest thing that comes into terms of how good of a player you are. If you have extremely good tempo, you're going to be able to seek out opportunities quicker, and you're just going to be able to spot them more often because you're on the map more frequently and you're in the right place, right time, right? When you're on the place, if you're on the map quicker, you're going to be able to have priority in your lane because, you know, you're there first, you're able to auto attack the minion first, you're able to push the wave first, you're able to hit them first, you're able to zone them off of a you're able to zone them away from objectives because you're there first. Master Yi gets right out the queue, and I decide to immediately shoot an arrow out as quick as possible. And right here, we're in a fight without our Lucian, so we are lacking a bit of damage, but I'm making sure I'm keeping my good positioning by just hitting Garen first. But it takes us so long to kill Garen that they're actually able to turn this fight around. Kai'Sa ults in, I exhaust the Kai'Sa, but I can't get out of this cage, so I end up having to just die. And this was really bad by us because they ended up getting 4 kills, but our Lucian is split pushing, so he is going to try to get that inhib for us. So at least we don't lose out on everything. But honestly, dropping 4 people is not really the best. But since we are so ahead, it's not the worst thing that can happen. The Lucian ends up killing the Master Yi, flashing onto the Kai'Sa, gets the Kai'Sa kill. I really do think that the Lucian could have played that a little bit better. And he would have been able to kill all 3 of them. But I guess it is what it is. And he ends up does falling. Or he could have maybe just killed the Vhagar and maybe not flashed on Kai'Sa, so he could have killed two and lived. So I don't think that was the best way to go about it, but he got the inhib and two kills, which is great for us. I decide to ult right here, I think, soon, because they're kind of trying to push towards my Nunu, and we start auto-attacking the Garen and realizing, hey, man, this guy's really caught forward. He can't be here. So we secure the kill onto Garen. I protobelt forward to get the slow onto the Lulu, which forces the Lulu to flash. And sadly, since they're all bunched up in mid, they're able to take down the Rift Herald without us having much of a say-so about it. Baron's still up, but, you know, it's really hard in rank to really work together to get to secure the Baron. I feel like that's what tends to slow games down, because since we're not able to do Baron, like, our Lucian's going down to bot, and we're wasting time right here instead of maybe recalling. Like, I could have reset it, but instead I'm coming and wasting time here. So right here, Vhagar decides to move forward, but I end up Ash ulting him, and I secure the kill onto Vhagar, and I auto attack the Master Yi, which actually slows him into a Lux root. And I do end up securing the Master Yi kill, which is a nice little double. So right when this happens, I'm like, okay, I recognize, let's shove out the wave. We can't do the objective right now because our jungler is dead. So let's shove out the wave and let's look for this mid inhib. And if we can't get the mid inhib, then at least we tried, right? So right here, we're pushing in the wave and we're hitting the mid turret. We get the mid turret and I'm not wasting time in their base, right? I'm going immediately straight down to bot and helping our Lucian secure the bottom turret. So this is like a really good pro rotation right there. We're playing the map. We're playing the map. We're not all A-ramming. You don't want to be A-ramming. You want to be playing smart. So the solution is doing a great job of split pushing for us. We end up leaving because I have 3k gold. I want to shop, but the Lux ends up in a bad position where I kind of stay. I miss my Ash ult onto the Kai'Sa because the Kai'Sa does end up ulting it. I end up getting the kill onto the Kai'Sa, but I overextended by trying to get the Kai'Sa kill that I ended up dying, which was really bad. So we ended up dropping the support, and I ended up dying, which was not the best. That fight could have... See, like, in that situation, I don't know if I should have just let the Lux, like, kind of die. Like, I don't know. But I think I forced way too hard on the Kai'Sa. I should have just let the Kai'Sa kind of live after I missed my Ash ult. And the reason why I missed my Ash ult was because I was hesitating. I thought the Kai'Sa ult was going to already ult. So then I didn't ult, but then I was like, damn, she's not ulting, so let me ult, and then she ult. So it was kind of unfortunate. So either I should have chosen a different target to ult, or I should have just ulted right away, like right as I seen her, and it would have been harder for her to react to that. So with that, like that, and that's the thing with Ashe, guys, like, there's gonna be a lot of opportunities, and you have to be very smart and calculated and take them right away, and you need to feel confident in yourself. And it's a huge thing with confidence. Like, there's a lot of times where sometimes I'm like, damn, I don't feel like playing Ashe because I don't feel confident in myself to be able to cross map snipe right now. So yeah, and sometimes when I play Ashe in competitive, I'm like, damn, okay, I gotta make sure I really spot out these opportunities and I take it, right? Because I'm the playmaker. So right when we get Baron, I Ashe ult Kai'Sa immediately. Kai'Sa tries to get out of there, so I exhaust the Kai'Sa. And we end up chasing her down, securing the kill onto the Kai'Sa. And we start pushing out this mid lane so we can finally end the game. Look for some more picks. The Vhagar ends up overextending, so I protobelt forward onto the Vhagar. The Vhagar is in stasis, so I'm timing my W. I end up getting the W and popping the Lulu, and that is game. So anyways, guys, I hope you guys did enjoy the video. Make sure to give this build and pick a try, and let me know what you guys think of it. And let me know about some other Ashe builds that you guys like to personally use, and I'd like to see what your guys' overall thoughts are. Anyways, we got MVP and the most damage. I'll catch you guys in the next one. Peace.